Welcome back to this class. Today we will look at pulsatile flow, again in some detail of mathematical complexity. As done for the unsteady flow, I am not going to get too much into the mathematical basis for the various things. I am just going to present the results. The people who are so interested can go and pick up the details from other books and so on and so forth. The various aspects of involved functions. Let's go forward. Pulsatile flow, and many important flows in our body are pulsatile in nature. We know that our heart pumps, and therefore the flow of blood is not a continuous one but a pulsatile one. Let us see how to handle that. How do we approach this flow? If we look at the pressure gradient, in this case the pressure gradient is varying with time. Our pumps, pumps, pumps. So instead of having a constant delta P, you have a time varying delta P, right? That's the basic difference here. So far we have considered a linear time invariant pressure gradient, and now we need to consider a time variant pressure gradient. As a first approximation, mathematical approximation, we can consider a sinusoidal pressure gradient to represent the flows through our vasculature. A time varying sinusoidal pressure gradient can provide valuable insights into the nature of pulsatile biological flows. Even though the actual variation could be a lot more complex, a first approximation to a time varying pressure drop can be obtained by using a sinusoidal variation of the pressure drop. Okay. Let us assume that the axial velocity at a particular radial position does not change with the length of the tube. This is the assumption that we made earlier also. Otherwise, the flow becomes all over the place. We cannot even handle it. And this approximation is not too bad an approximation. So, this is fine. Now, we will consider equation C2 from table 3.4-2, which gives us the z component. So, it is this. Based on these assumptions, of course, it is varying with time. The pressure drop is varying with time, therefore, the velocity will vary with time. So, this term remains. There is no VR. Okay, we said still the flow is in laminae, in this case cylindrical laminae. Therefore, Vz is not a function of R. In any case, the Vz is a function of R. The VR, there is no VR here, and therefore, the VR is set to 0. There is no V theta, we will consider a perpendicular thing, therefore there is no Vr here, there is no V theta here, and Vz is not a function of Z, well developed flow let us say, and therefore that can be set to 0. Dp dz exists, there is a negative there, plus mu 1 by r dou dou r dou Vz dou r, this remains, Vz is a function of r. Vz is not a function of theta, Vz is not a function of theta, therefore this term goes to 0. And Vz is not a function of Z, well developed flow, this term goes to 0. Gz of course is G. Okay. So what this turns out to be is rho dou Vz dou t equals minus dou p minus rho Gz, I've combined these two the same way as earlier, dou Z, plus mu by r dou Vz dou r. Okay. So this is equation 3.6-1. And now, let us, earlier we just took delta P by L as a pressure gradient. Here we are going to represent the pressure gradient as dou, which is dou P dou Z, as a constant term plus a time varying term, okay, minus delta P by L plus A sine omega T, a sinusoidal variation of the pressure gradient. Equation 3.6-2, delta P by L, as I mentioned, is the average pressure gradient. A and omega are the amplitude and frequency respectively. It's switched around here. A is amplitude, omega is the frequency of the periodic pressure function. And equation of motion in terms of the kinetic viscosity, nu by rho, would be 1 by nu dou Vz dou t equals 1 by r dou Vz dou r, plus this pressure term here, pressure variation term, minus delta P by mu L plus A by mu sine omega T. Okay. equation 3.6-3. A guess for the solution, okay, I'm not getting into the details of the math, guess for the solution, Vz consists of the steady state part, an average part, and a fluctuating part, the same approach as earlier, corresponding to the average and fluctuating pressure gradients. And therefore, Vz, which is a function of R and T, is an average value, which is a function of R alone, not a function of T, plus a time varying fluctuating component Vz dash, which is a function of both R and T. Equation 3.6-4. Now, if we substitute 3.6-4 and 3.6-3 that we just saw, the equations that we just saw, with the recognition that Vz dash is not a function of T, then 0 equals 1 by R d dr r dvz dash dr plus minus delta P by mu L. Okay, we did this. We substituted this into this. Vz dash is not a function of T, therefore all those, it's only a function of R, and there is a standard component, an average component and a fluctuating component. Therefore, this equation reduces to this. Okay. Equation 3.6-5, and 1 by nu dou Vz dash dou T equals 1 by R dou R R dou Vz dash dou R plus A by mu sine omega T, which is what we get from the earlier expression 3.6-6. And we have already seen the solution to this 3.6-5 in the earlier section. Okay, go back and check, we would have seen the solution there, which was nothing but Vz bar equals minus delta P R squared by 4 mu L. The velocity in laminar flow, the average velocity in laminar flow, average velocity component in laminar flow, minus delta P R squared by 4 mu L, 1 minus R by R squared, equation 3.6-7. And 3.6.6 can be solved by Laplace transforms as through a lengthy procedure. The needed boundary conditions are this: at R equals 0, dou Vz dash bar, dou R, dou Vz prime, let us say dash, dou R equals 0. At boundary condition 2, at R equals R, Vz dash, the average value equals 0. And the combined solution just being presented here will be this. Okay. Vzrt equals, you can recognize this from earlier, plus T2a by rho, the amplitude of the wave, sum of the Bessel function of the first kind, Bessel function of the second kind, a function of omega, and so on and so forth, a complex solution. Okay. What I would like you to do is just take some constant values for this. See, use various values of R in an Excel sheet, then plot the Excel sheet for various R's at a given time and see what is the kind of variation, what is the kind of profile that you get for Vz as a function of T for a particular, Vz as a function of R for a particular T, then change T and then you get another curve, then change T, then you get another curve. And see how the velocity profile evolves in pulsatile flow with time. Okay, the velocity profile is a variation of Vz with R, how that evolves with time in pulsatile flow. The solution is this. Equation 3.6-8. And how it varies from the basal parabolic profile is what I would like you to find out. The variation is cyclic, as you would expect, because pressure variation, the pressure drop variation is cyclic, sine wave, and therefore the variation velocity will also be cyclic. Now let me present a few thoughts and leave you at that. Mathematical effort to get analytical solutions could be daunting. However, we prefer analytical solutions because it is reasonably complete, although with assumptions, but those assumptions can be verified. If they are not appropriate, then you need to go back and work out, rework the solution with appropriate assumptions. And they are capable of rendering themselves to confident interpretations due to the continuous nature of analytical solutions. In numerical solutions, you don't have this continuous nature. So, we are always limited by that. But if you don't get an analytical solution at all, what do? You need to get to numerical solutions. Analytical solutions may not be available for all situations. Even this was quite daunting. Therefore, it's common to take a numerical approach, such as a finite element method, to solve the equations. A significant expertise is needed for appropriate use and interpretation of numerical solutions. It's not easy either, but at least it gives you some solution. Even if one does not possess such expertise, one can always team up with a suitable expert in numerical solutions for the solution. That's why people work in teams. You come up with something, you may not be an expert in numerical solutions, but you have a colleague who is an expert, so you go and talk to that person and get that person's expertise as to how to interpret this numerical solution, whether it makes sense at all to begin with, and then how do you get deeper insights into it. And then both these expertises together is what solves a bigger problem. That's why people work in teams. Further, one can use some formulations for simplifying the solutions of differential equations. Okay, these are old formulations. Let me just present them. These are well-established formulations. I'm just going to tell you the basis of the formulation, nothing else. Okay, and just two examples of those. The first example is that of use of stream functions, what are called stream functions. The second is use of something called a boundary layer theory. Okay, let me explain what these are. Stream functions are something like this. The velocity is expressed as a gradient of a certain potential or a certain stream function, say phi. So, if it's a two-dimensional case, Vx is represented as a negative of the y derivative of xi, the stream function or the potential. So, Vx is minus of dou y of xi, and Vy is expressed as plus dou x of xi. So, this formulation significantly reduces the mathematical tedium. And xi indicates streamlines, the path traced by particles under of fluid under steady flow. So, it has a physical relevance. So, xi is not a conceptual one, it also has a physical relevance. It is still conceptual, streamlines are conceptual, but these are constant along streamlines. Okay. The next thing is boundary layer flow. Boundary layer theory assumes or splits the flow into two regions. For example, if you have a flow through a pipe, or that's a bad example, flow over a flat plate. There is a certain region that is affected by the plate, certain region in the flow that's affected by the plate, and there's a huge region that's not affected by the plate. Okay, so you split those and then solve them separately and then put them together. That's all the boundary layer theory allows you to do. It's a lot more complex when there is an effect of the plate on the flow. All the boundary layer effects will come in. So, just to tell you the essence of it, it is essentially the flow is split into two parts. Potential flow away from the wall, where you can assume density to be a constant. Viscosity is actually zero and the flow is irrotational. Flow is irrotational, mathematically it is expressed as del cross V equals zero. That's how irrotational flow is defined. And a boundary layer flow, which is close to the walls, here the viscous effects are important. The viscous effects are all the ones that bring in the second derivatives of velocities with respect to space, and all those complications are addressed close to the wall. Okay. So, this is normally done. Stream function approach, boundary layer approach is normally taken. When you come across these in the literature, you won't be lost. Okay, you know what this is, and then you can get into the formulations, the deeper formulations, the mathematics and so on and so forth, and understand that better if you need to understand that. So, in this course, we have given you just a peek into that, just the basis of that. You can develop on that for your own needs as you go along. Okay. I think we need to stop here for this class. let us continue with something else in the next class. I think we are going to look at turbulent flow in the next class. We'll do that when we come back again. See you then.